So hello.
Hello.
My name is Rodrigo Gama. I'm here with Warren Spector, the creator of Deus Ex, Epic Mickey, among other games. Let's start from the beginning. Before computer game design, you've had an enviable past with both Steve Jackson Games and TSR. This kind of experience, which in pen and paper role-playing game design isn't as common in developers these days. Do you think the current industry lacks these bases for a better understanding of game development's roots?
I think my experience at Steve Jackson Games and TSR set me up for success in electronic game development. But not necessarily in the ways people might expect. I mean, on the one hand, I had to unlearn so many things. You have no idea. There's such complete creative freedom when you're dealing with a tabletop game. If your players don't want to fight one night, they don't have to fight that night because there's a human dungeon master or game master there to change the experience for them on the fly. In the world of electronic games, if you don't pre-plan it, it can't happen. So in that sense, I came in thinking that in the electronic game world, I was going to have as much freedom as I had in tabletop games, but I didn't. So I had to learn that. On the other hand, the experience of telling stories with other people, which is the heart of tabletop gaming, has driven every single step of my career in electronic gaming. It's sad to say, I've spent the last 25 years. I spent about 5 years in tabletop games. I've spent the last 25 years in electronic games just trying to recapture that feeling I had when I was playing D&D back in the 70s and 80s. So I learned a lot. I had to unlearn a lot. And the paper game space has provided a foundation for my entire career.
I think these roots helped you become a tester for Strategic Simulations Incorporated, after which you became a quest and story writer for Origins games, such as Ultima 6, Space Rogue. And this marked the use of especially isometric graphics, 16-bit technology. Ultima 6, I think it was the first game that was shipped to be working with sound, to be working with a mouse, to for bigger computers. And what do you think this change in technology did in accordance to what developers could do to impress players, to mess around with players, with the design?
One of the things that keeps me making games and that makes me so convinced that game development is the only career I could possibly have had is that there's a pretty much complete change in technology every 6 months to a year. You know, what we were doing a year ago is no longer the state of the art now. And every time the technology changes, we get new capabilities. Now, a lot of developers use that power just to create prettier pictures or more impressive soundscapes. And I think it's not exactly a waste, but it's pretty close to a waste of time and energy and someone's money. I think increased power gives us the ability to provide completely new experiences, new approaches to AI, new approaches to the user experience, to the user interface. I think we can, with new technology, we can actually make new kinds of games. There was, up to the point where Ultima 6 debuted, there'd never been a game like that. It wasn't just that it was prettier. It was that there was a whole new way of interacting with the game. There was a much more deeply interactive world than anybody had ever created. Yes, the graphics were better. Yes, the sound was better. But it was the play that was better, the play that was different. And that wasn't the last time that happened. I mean, when PCs became more powerful, that was the only reason Chris Roberts could make Wing Commander. That was the only reason that there was new technology that made new kinds of gameplay possible. And that's been true ever since. Every 6 months to a year, we can, when we want to, make a completely different kind of game. Because, and I don't think we do that often enough. We just make prettier pictures and more beautiful sound.
Because I remember when Wing Commander came out, it was...
You don't remember when Wing Commander came out.
I remember a few years later.
Okay.
Still, Ultima Underworld might be defined as one of the first games of a design you mastered, the non-linear first-person action RPG. This is something you've successfully built on several games, and even though you've had other endeavors, you haven't strayed far from this specific genre since. Combining the practicality of direct action, which is only implied in the more traditional RPGs, with a camera perspective that helps the player feel their own character, as well as the non-linear fashion of a bigger world. Do you consider this to be the kind of game that offers what RPGs built up to for years because of the technological limitations? Do you consider this to be the ultimate experience in terms of roleplay? Not, I know there's still the interaction of the Dungeon Master to be concerned about, but overall, in terms of experience, in terms of what technology can offer.
Well, okay, for starters, it's important to understand that I didn't make Ultima Underworld. Ultima Underworld was made by an incredibly talented team at Blue Sky. I was just lucky enough to be the producer that got to, you know, sort of push those guys in a direction that I thought was the right direction. But all credit to the team on that game. It was a team of, I think, 7 people. So to say that any one person created Underworld is just insane. But in terms of the game itself, I was so inspired by that team and so inspired by the possibilities of first-person perspective, real-time, fully textured 3D worlds, that I pretty much decided right then and there that I never wanted to make a different kind of game. And it was only reluctantly that years later I started making third-person games. If I could just make any kind of game the way I want to make it tomorrow, it would be a first-person perspective game, just because I think there's nothing better than first-person at putting you in another world. It's not just some character you're playing. It's not some puppet you're manipulating. It's not even some incredibly cool character whose actions you're driving. It's you in the world. And what could be more exciting than that? What could be more game-like than that? So I absolutely think that first-person perspective, real-time 3D is the best expression of the best things video games can do. There's no question. I'm a total believer in first-person perspective, 3D real-time gaming. It defines gaming for me in a very real sense.
Thank you. And that leads me to my next question, which is about Deus Ex. It's still considered your masterpiece. It's not only considered one of the most successful genre design hybrid of all time, it's a game that for most people still hasn't been surpassed. And I think that for the most part this is due to the highly experimental nature of the game, as well as attention to details within the world when letting the player try different things outside of the usual constraints of gameplay. How important do you consider these details, which end up being insignificant to about 95% of the players who are just interested in playing a game to the end?
Wow, there are about 100 questions implied by that. I think the concept of player choice with consequences is absolutely critical to games as a medium and as an art form. There are a handful of things that we do that other media don't, and giving people real choices to make in real time and then showing them the consequences of those choices is the defining thing that games do. So all those details that you describe, they are the game for me. It's not about shooting stuff or sneaking or talking to people. It's about deciding how you want to interact with the world. It's all of those details and letting players decide how to interact with all of those detailed situations and scenarios. I'll tell you don't know how many times I had arguments with people who would say, how many people are going to sneak through this game? How many people are going to sneak? Everybody's just going to go shooting. And I would say, I don't care if it's one person who's going to sneak through the game. We're making a game that allows sneaking. I was completely unwilling to compromise, because even if it was just, it was a lot more than one person, by the way, but even if it was just one person, I was going to show the world that you could make a game that allowed players to determine how to interact with their game world. It was a direct response to my frustration with the Thief games. I mean, I worked on the Thief games, and actually I had nothing to do with Thief 2. Okay,
and
but
Thief 1, you worked on it when it was Dark Age of Camelot, right?
Yeah, and a little bit after it became Thief. I was there for the middle year of a three-year development cycle. So I will claim that I was a part of the development of Thief 1, and I was very much a part of the development of Thief 3, Thief Deadly Shadows. But Thief 2, I was not there at all for that. But I remember when we were working on the first Thief game, I would sit in meetings with the team, and they would say, I would say, look, I'm just not good enough to sneak. In this specific scenario that you've set up in the game, I was playing through that level, and I'm just not good enough. My option here is I'm going to stop playing because I was not a good enough thief to get past the problem that they had thrown at me. Let me kill the guard. Just let me do it. And the team would say, no, if we empower the player enough that he or she can kill the guards, no one will ever sneak. It will just completely undercut the core gameplay. And I argued and argued and argued. And at the end of the day, when everybody in your team is saying you're wrong, you want to let the team do what the team wants to do, okay? Because all of us are smarter than any one of us. So Thief was the game that it was, and there are places in that game that are still too hard for me, you know? But I decided at that moment I was going to show them, I was going to show this team, the Thief team, that you could make a game that was about combat or sneaking or the sort of talking aspects of role-playing. I was going to put all that together in a game, and that's exactly where Deus Ex came from. It was about that frustration.
And the solution would be to make each kind of route, each kind of gameplay as fun as the other.
It was about making each of them as fulfilling, and it was about creating a world that supported all of them equally. It wasn't about creating the ultimate stealth path. It was about creating AI that could deal with you whether you were sneaking or fighting. It was about creating non-player characters that wanted to talk to you, not just kill you. You know, it was about all of those details that you mentioned. The Deus Ex is about its details more than anything else. And it was lucky that I managed to put together a team that bought into that vision, because, again, it's not about an individual. I didn't create Deus Ex. Deus Ex was the creation of a team of incredibly talented people all pulling in a single direction to create a game like nothing anyone had ever made before. That's the end of my answer. Sorry. I realized that I just dropped you off a cliff there.
No, you didn't. It's great. It actually leads me to another one, which is you're one of the few well-known game authors these days. I've already made this question before. With the industry veering towards bigger teams and productions, games have lost a lot of the personal touch that many directors and producers eventually sought to give them. But at the same time, we've seen a rise in indie projects, as well as many of the older creators using crowdfunding to bring their projects back. And what do you think overall about this path that the industry in general is taking?
Well, I think you've overstated the case. I think there are still people, even working in the mainstream of AAA gaming, you know, the sort of what we think of as games, I think there are still people who have a personal style that stands out. I mean, I hope the games that I've directed and produced have had a distinctiveness about them that, you know, people play and they can say, oh, that's a game that Warren Spector was involved with. And I know when I play a Will Wright game, I don't have to look at the credits. I know Will Wright made it. And Sid Meier and Peter Molyneux and just a handful of others. I mean, it is probably a handful, to be frank. But I think there is more individual creative statement making in mainstream gaming than you're giving that medium credit for. It's clearly easier when you have a team of three to make a personal statement. There's no question. And I'm really thrilled that there is an indie movement, which didn't exist 10 years ago. You know, the indie scene now is vibrant and growing, and it means that a lot more people are making personal statements. I mean, to give you a perfect example, there was a guy who worked on Deus Ex Invisible War named Kent Hudson, who recently, by himself, made a game called The Novelist, which is terrific. It's a terrific game. And it's taking the ideas that we were trying to express in the games that he worked on with me and with others at Ion Storm, and he's taking them in a whole different direction because it's his statement about that kind of game, about games that empower players to tell their own stories. And you know, Kent probably wouldn't have gotten that chance if he were part of a team of 200. But if he had been directing that team, if he'd been the guy who was leading the charge and saying, okay, guys, that's the hill we're taking, go take it, he would have been able to make just as personal a statement. It's just that 100 people on planet Earth get the chance to make the personal statement in the mainstream of gaming, and in indie gaming, you can have 10,000 people who get to make their personal statements. So it's just more obvious, I think, in the indie space. But I don't think it's...
There are overall more games. And there
overall
are
games, more games being made.
There's overall more individuality and freedom within those games.
Exactly, exactly. I don't think it's that there's no individuality and no artistic statement being made in traditional console games, for example. It's just that there's greater opportunity in the indie space to do that.
All right, and for the last question, recently with Junction Point Studios, you find yourself building a kind of dream project, something personal to you. You're a Disney fan. And not only returning Walt Disney's original creation back home after all these years, but also creating two games in a genuine Disney universe you've always wanted to work with, as well as being given the chance to write for a Return of DuckTales, the comic.
Yeah.
How was the whole experience with Disney?
It was amazing. It was absolutely amazing. I mean, when I told my mother that I was working with Disney, her response wasn't, are you crazy? It wasn't congratulations. It was, it's about time. That was what she told me. It's about time. And it was about time. Nobody believes me when I say this, but the amount of creative freedom they gave me and gave my team was just astonishing. They said no to like two things. I couldn't have Mickey furrow his brow. He has this brow where a lot of his acting comes from. And I couldn't have it come down too far because it made him look too angry. And I couldn't show Mickey's teeth. That was it. Other than that, they let us do whatever we wanted. And so that kind of creative freedom with a character that is better known than any other icon on planet Earth, how many people get that opportunity? You know, nobody gets that kind of opportunity. And then to be able to bring back Oswald the Lucky Rabbit after 80 years. I mean, you don't even have to be a Disney fan to know how cool an opportunity that is. So it was pretty dreamlike for most of the time.
We need to go.
All right. Then, thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Spector.
Oh, it was great. Thanks for asking me all these great questions.